about now? All right, well, I'm going to yell anyway. Thanks for spending some time here tonight with me, and thank you to everyone at Bishop's for having me. I love the environment, actually. The idea that I'm going to be able to give a lecture at Bishop's is kind of fun, because I expect to maybe teach a little bit, but really answer some questions. So while I'm speaking, I hope you feel free to hold me up and ask something. And I believe that we've got, what, about 35, 45 minutes?
40 minutes.
40 minutes? Perfect. And I'm going to talk to you today about what we do at the La Jolla Institute and what immunologists do in general. So La Jolla Institute adopted a tagline called Life Without Disease. And I think that when you read something like that, it seems too fantastic, too outlandish. It sounds like a marketing gimmick. Life without disease. You have to make your taglines short. So what it really is to connote is this idea that if we do what we're supposed to be doing in medical research, we can all enjoy a long and healthy life without feeling the symptoms of disease. Even that, when you think about it, it really sounds over the top. No symptoms of disease. So let's travel back in time a little bit and think about another outlandish tagline that might have been put up on billboards, let's say in the late 50s. It would have read this, life without polio, right? Crazy talk. Back after World War II and the Cold War, what people were worried about is getting bombed by nuclear weapons and catching polio. So this would have been nuts. Okay? Now, of course, life with polio at the time was you would be born, and through a matter of chance, you would encounter viruses, including the polio virus, throughout your life, and you'd get sick. And the symptoms would be some form of polio, poliomyelitis, and 95% of the time, you would recover without any intervention, and you'd go on the rest of your life seemingly polio-free. But about 5% of the time, you wouldn't fully recover. In fact, you might die, or you might end up with permanent disabilities and paralysis. Now, we know the end of the story, and that is that a vaccine was made. So early in life, as a young child, you get vaccinated, but you still encounter the polio virus. The polio virus would come into your body, but because you were vaccinated, you didn't feel any of the symptoms of polio, and you lived a life without polio, without the symptoms of disease. It's that simple. That's what we're after. Not getting rid of every virus, bacteria, cancer, everything else, but to be able to live naturally in this environment without feeling the symptoms of those things. So how do you get there? Well, today what I'm going to talk about is the research on the immune system, so that what it should yield is that same kind of preventative medicine, the most powerful kind that gets there before you're sick, that gets there before you feel all those symptoms, that activates your immune system so that you can go through and live life and take advantage of the things that you're naturally ready to do. I think the twist is to consider that preventative medicine outside of the realm of infectious disease. So not just, say, a vaccine against a polio virus or a measles virus or something like that, but just generally speaking, against all disease. So I'm an immunologist. As soon as someone finds out what that is, and they say, what is that again? Immune system. All right, what about Ebola, Dr. Wilson? So a little current events here. Ebola has inspired a lot of truths and mistruths. There's been a lot of media attention. It's a very scary disease when you look at the patients. I didn't put any gruesome images up there, but it's right up there with, like, people turning into zombies, right? It's very scary. It somehow attacks our psyche. And it's all over the world because it can be spread, but it's mostly in West Africa. As we know, we've all learned about donning and doffing and all this kind of stuff to protect yourself. But Ebola is like other infectious disease, and it involves the immune system. Primarily, when you get infected with Ebola virus, it goes into many cells, including these things called monocytes, which are part of your immune system. And your immune system responds by secreting a bunch of cytokines, these local hormones that allow cells to communicate with each other. And basically, it turns on your immune system, and it tries to do something about it. And if the disease isn't halted at that stage, it goes on to infect endothelial cells. And the endothelial cells are kind of the lining of all of your tubes. So all of your vessels and barriers are full of endothelial cells. And those cells start to detach or die, and you leak. And that's the Ebola that kills you. So when your immune system isn't able to fight a virus in time, because it hasn't seen it or can't keep up, you end up having this. The other questions I get are, how many people are going to die of Ebola? But a better question, the one that I wish I would have, I got more often is, can you imagine if we just had an effective vaccine? It wouldn't even be newsworthy. We would hear about an outbreak. We would go vaccinate the locals. They would all be immune, and they could live in the environment without Ebola. And it's scary because when you don't have effective vaccines and you come across these things like Ebola, and it could be something else, right? Ebola is an example. The numbers of people who will be affected could be tens of thousands, could be hundreds of thousands. So it's an important and question of human health to be able to deal with it, because Ebola is just one example of many things that we may be looking at. So I can't go too far down the line without talking about the immune system. Any other immunologists out there tonight? I saw you raise your hand. You're an immunologist. That's great. Oh. Just kidding. So we all know what immunity is, but in a lay sense. And I think that to really get into the guts and have some fun with it, I'm going to talk a little bit more about the immune system. So where is it? What is it? How does it work? Well, the immune system is the things that aren't the other stuff. So as a human being, I look at us as bacterial cells and human cells. And then of the human cells, since we all started as single cell organisms, what we differentiated into is we keep some of our stem cells for life, and then we turn into specialized things, brain, hair, heart, lungs. Everything else is basically an immune cell. And these immune cells actually aren't passive. They are interdigitated. They're in there amongst all of your other cells everywhere you look. And they're there for health as well as for disease. So your immune system is not something that's sitting in your immune gland waiting to come out when something happens. It's everywhere. As a matter of fact, if you take a look at tissues like fat, brain, muscle, they're loaded with immune cells. Most of them are these things called macrophages or monocytes. They're in there cleaning up the debris and doing all the sort of janitorial work that allows the other specialized cells like fat, brain, and muscle to work. And so there they are. Okay? In fat, you know, 10 to 15% of the cells are not even fat cells. They're immune cells. So that means that your immune system is everywhere, and your health and the disease is also just as widespread everywhere those cells are. So another way to look at your immune system, all these pieces, is through this pictograph that I made here of a puzzle. So your immune system starts off as kind of a system of barriers, the things that keep the outside world on the outside, the tears and saliva that you have that have enzymes that just naturally are bacterial or microbicidal, low stomach pH, so when you put something in your mouth from the outside world, that can take care of it. And then it goes on to a fast-acting form of your immune system that's really, truly part of this system of cells. Things like mast cells, macrophages, and some things you probably have heard of. So histamine. Just about everybody has taken an antihistamine. So you have an allergic reaction, you're feeling sick, you take an antihistamine. These are all very fast-acting. So when you run, if you're allergic to pollen, you know it, because you go outside and all of a sudden you just start oozing. Immediately. It doesn't take a week or two. That's its fast acting. Then there's a third arm that's really exciting. It's called adaptive immunity. And the reason why it's cool is because if these basic barriers and the fast acting immune response aren't enough, your immune system can sit there and study the problem and actually get highly specialized and fixated and in fact form memories. And when you are vaccinated or when you naturally run into things in the environment, it's this part of your immune system that can actually become very specialized and then remember it. And so the next time you run into the same thing, your immune system is already educated and can very quickly react. That's pretty good, because then you don't have to worry about that ramp-up time. So when you get sick, it's often the feelings that you have is your immune system activating and going through the long process of becoming better and better. Now, at the Institute, we don't have to do the anatomy of the immune system. People have been studying it for a long time. What we look at is the signals that interlock all these things, that allow all these pieces to come together. And the magic that's in there is that you basically have this immune system that's like a biological computer. It can figure out, you can be immune to plastic. You can be immune to a Martian bacteria. Your immune system actually figures things out as it goes along. And it does it through what is practically a computer system. So we're looking for all those signals and receptors. And trust me, it's really complicated. We haven't figured it all out. Now, the other thing that we're all familiar with, I think, is inflammation. Inflammation is is when you get hurt and things swell up. It's all that kind of stuff. As a matter of fact, the immune system is even, or inflammation is even simpler to remember. It's the immune system in action. And so it's normal, right? So let's say this is a pictograph again of like a splinter pushing through your skin, poking the outside world on the inside. And cells and various immune factors come in. They cause the tissues around it to swell because the vessels open up and let fluid into the space so that the traffic can get in. So all those immune cells and all those things needed to fix a problem can come in. And what you feel is swelling. And you feel pain because your nerves don't like it either. And then you see redness because all of a sudden blood's at the surface and it's normally down in your vessels. And then if it's really bad, you start to stiffen up and everything goes wonky and you put ice on it and everything else. That's your immune system doing all that. That's not the virus, that's not the splinter. Well, that same powerful immune system can also cause problems. And so allergy, asthma, any kind of allergy is simply defined as your immune system reacting to something that's basically safe. It's not a danger to you, but you overreact. And so the problem is all the symptoms of the immune system. Autoimmune diseases like rheumatoid arthritis, unlike osteoarthritis, rheumatoid is your immune system attacking, and I'll talk about these a little bit more. So inflammation is the immune system in action. It's normal, and it's important. Without it, things wouldn't get done. But if it lingers, it can cause tissue damage, and in the end, becomes the cause of many diseases. And so you've got this two-sidedness of your immune system, and all through life, it's this balance that's trying to be struck. So it's about time and location. Now, to talk about disease in the immune system is pretty natural. Right here is just a list that I pulled. This is the top 10 causes of death. Death is an awful measure of how healthy you are, but you have to start with some list. So here you go, there's 10 of them. They're diseases I think everybody knows about, and if you look up on there, probably see them on it. These are accidents, right? Now you can rearrange them and remove a couple over here that are not immune-related. So accidents and suicide are almost never your immune system getting into trouble. But then what I added back are other diseases that maybe aren't in the top 10 causes of death, certainly cause a lot of morbidity. Now, the eye chart up here is about 80-some diseases that are autoimmune in nature. And the reason I rearranged everything and put the line in between is because you can also categorize all these diseases and many, many more as too much immune system activity, or too little. Not the end cause, the primary cause, the central cause of these diseases. So as an example, if you had influenza and you had too little immune system activity, you feel sick. The influenza virus and all of the disease symptoms come out, right? If you had enough, you wouldn't feel it. Diabetes. Autoimmune diabetes. If your immune system wasn't acting too much, you wouldn't have the disease. It's central to it. You're not going to read the newspapers the same after tonight. Every disease out there that you hear about, just about every one of them, it's really hard to find. Congenital diseases are an exception, a couple of them. But everything else is an immune disease. So that's cool. Not because of disease, but because first you can categorize health as having things in the right place at the right time. But you can also attack disease now. And you, rather than looking at it as some kind of bad luck, you can look at it systematically. You can look at it as a mechanism that you can re-engineer, that you can do something about. So what we want to do, essentially, in the most simple way, is we want to change things so that your immune system is not too suppressed, where you end up with things like cancer or chronic infection. And it's not too activated, where you get things like autoimmune disease and allergy. We want to get it just right in that Goldilocks zone, where there's equal amounts of activation and suppression. Interesting. All right. Everyone upgrade to Yosemite? That could be it. I'm finding that we're going to really see if I was the network administrator. Yeah. All right. So anyway, how are we going to do it? This is where we need to get the nuts and bolts, and I think go into specific examples. So let's start with the big one, heart disease, atherosclerosis. If you ever needed a good reason to work on a disease like this, well, 1 in 4 deaths are going to be caused by it. There's $110 billion a year in economic damage. 17.3 million people are going to die each year. It's a great disease to get rid of. The history of treatment actually goes back a long time, and for a while we treated the symptoms, and we looked at things like nitroglycerin, bypass surgery, things to open up those arteries feeding the heart that led to heart disease. And the greatest evolution up until recently was to pry open, it was like, so I was a pretty good plumber in my day, to pry open the pipe and coat it with drugs that'll keep the pipe open. That was state of the art. Now what's come into the mix are these drugs called statins. Now what statins were developed to do is to reduce the amount of cholesterol that's being synthesized and reprocessed. Because when you look in atherosclerosis, you see a lot of cholesterol in the exact same places where you have problems in heart disease. So see where the cholesterol, right? But as it turns out, even with really good statins, and these are all just a bunch of different clinical studies that have been done over the years, the best you're gonna do is get it down so that the difference between taking a statin and not taking a statin gets you about a 30% better chance of not having a major acute cardio event, or what's known as a heart attack, death, things like that. So it's not 100%. Why not? Because atherosclerosis is a chronic inflammatory disease. So what this picture is a normal heart turning into an abnormal one. We're looking down the pipe here of a coronary artery, the artery that feeds fresh blood to the heart. And it's quite normal to have red blood cells carrying the oxygen, but also these white cells that are part of your immune system. And what they do is they're trucking along and they make specific stops and they actually leave the pipe and they squeeze through endothelial cells and they come into that interstitial space in between the heart muscle and everything else. And what they do is they start picking up lipid-covered debris, things basically the parts and pieces that have fallen apart. And this is their normal function. And what they normally do is they pop back into the vessel, they go where they needed to go, and you recycle the cholesterol, which was coating it, or you get rid of the things that it was coating. And you just keep the conveyor belt going. Well, what happens in atherosclerosis is the cells go in and they pick up all this debris and they become bloated. And they actually start to look like they're full of bubbles when you look at them microscopically. They call them foam cells because of that. It looks like they're full of like bubble bath. And they get in there and they basically get stuck. And so instead of going back in, they stay in there and then they die and then they become part of the problem. And they start to pound into each other. They cause more inflammation, a runaway feedback happens, and pretty soon what you end up with is what we all call a plaque. Then you've got problems. So what we found and what others have found is that there are ways to get in the way of that. But remember the statins, how they reduced that risk of atherosclerotic-related major artery diseases and cardiac events? Well, it turns out statins are pretty good anti-inflammatory drugs. And so people have gone on to make statins that are like super statins, where you can drop cholesterol down to levels that are ridiculously low. So low, it's dangerous. You actually need cholesterol. And that doesn't help. And so the major action of statins is being recognized not just as an anti-cholesterol drug, is it an anti-inflammatory drug? So one of the ideas that we're doing, because we're in research, is to take a look at a different kind of vaccine, a different kind of preventative action against heart disease. So normally with vaccines, you're trying to boost something that's got too little immune activity, right? But here, in the case of a chronic inflammatory disease like atherosclerosis, you have too much. So in the traditional sense, you would give a vaccine and boost your response. What we want to do is make something that dampens a response, that dampens that too much inflammation inside the cardiac artery. And as it turns out, we can do that because vaccines and the whole idea of vaccination has evolved. And so what we see is we've gone from making vaccines by basically scraping disease tissue, putting in a shot and giving it to you, to being able to engineer them from the pieces on up. And so we can make vaccines that jack up the volume and turn it down. Nobody's done it, but the theory is there. We've tracked humans. We know what each and every one of you do in terms of if I give you a vaccine, I could give you one and you one. They're different, but they both have the effects, okay, that we want. And so, I don't know, does it work? Well, it does. your mouse. So in mice, you can give them atherosclerotic lesions. They normally don't get atherosclerosis. You have to jam them full of fatty food and not let them run around. And then you vaccinate them against a specific protein, they get less plaque. So that's really good. And the vision would be to basically slow down the formation of atherosclerosis. So right now, atherosclerosis takes you 30, 40 years of hard work, actually the inverse of hard work, probably no hard work at all, eating all the wrong things, all that kind of stuff, bad genes, everything else. Well, what we want to do is we want to slow it down. So that takes 90 years, 100 years to get atherosclerosis. And it turns out you just won't get around to it. You'll die of something else. I'm going to switch gears and talk now about the microbiome, and in particular bacteria. So when I was a kid, just a few years ago, I was told germs are bad, get all the germs out, right? Wash, 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 wash. And we did. As a society, as a matter of fact, we've gotten so good at getting rid of germs, we don't get enough. And they are essential co-organisms. You can't make certain vitamins without them. You can't digest your food right without them, right? They crowd out the bad guys, all these things that we're learning. So we need to rethink infection and traditional vaccines. Because if you don't have vaccines, if you're just out there amongst the whole zoo of microbes, and you do get sick and you have an acute infection, you're going to take an antibiotic. And an antibiotic is like a nuclear bomb, right? It's going to get rid of a whole bunch of things and the thing that you want to get rid of. As it turns out, when you use antibiotics in very young kids, say in the first year of life, and then you track them 7 years later, and you look at the incidence of asthma at age 7, you use broad-spectrum penicillins, there's a 55% greater chance of getting asthma by the time you're 7. That's it. It's correlative. Okay. Why? We aren't sure, but there's some data coming in that's pretty good. Asthma around the world, where do you get asthma the most? In the places that are the most industrialized and cleanest. We have the least number of bacteria. So just like taking an antibiotic, you can live in a society that's super clean, right? And you get more asthma. So what are the hypotheses? These are ideas that have been kicked around for years, but data has come very slowly. This is data in the last couple of months. What it looks like is the presence of certain bacteria, especially in your lung, it forces your immune system to look at bacteria and everything it encounters, basically, in a more moderate way. In other words, your immune system is not hyped up. And so when it encounters things, instead of forming a super aggressive, super pointed attack, it can only have a mild attack. Well, now imagine if what comes into your lungs is grass pollen. Rather than having a super concentrated, super aggressive memory response, it can only attack the pollen and sort of leave it alone after that. That may be the simple balance to do it. And it's resident bacteria that basically keep your immune system in check. We've evolved with these organisms. It's a very specific humankind pathway. It's very interesting. Food allergies seem to be the same thing. Your gut is loaded with bacteria. It's amazing. There's way more bacteria in us than there's us. We're outnumbered. And they are crucial to everything we do. And so we've co-evolved, and having the right balance does it. I'll get back to it. But what's great is this is from now a fairly old textbook. And back when we were teaching everybody about immunology, we would say, well, you know, if you encounter worms, you know, or allergens, you use the same mechanism. And so now you can see how your immune system, since it uses the same mechanism to look at environmental allergens and dangerous parasites, it could get confused. That's where these things are starting to come. You have these overlapping functions, and then all of a sudden, there's some confusion, and you get these allergies because you don't have worms, right? It's a cool sort of thing. So what we want to do, of course, is get in the way of it. Nobody likes worms. I don't either. And so we want to basically keep the getting rid of parasites, keep the tissue repair, get rid of allergic inflammation, and move to something that's a little bit more like life without antibiotics. Because then we don't have to live with the downside of all that antibiotic use that blows away everything indiscriminately and then leads to the side effects. I love antibiotics in an emergency. I'm not anti-antibiotic. The other reason is because the more we understand how bacteria and viruses and microbes work with us, the more we can attack some other real health issues. So seasonal flu kills 25,000 people a year on average. And it's hard to distinguish who died of the flu virus and pneumonia. But it's still a very large number. It's really, really big after all these years, even with vaccination and everything else. and it's very expensive. But what's scary is pandemic flu. And the reason why is because pandemic flu, it's hard to see this, but pandemic flu doesn't kill the very old and weak or the very young and immature. It kills people with really strong immune systems, healthy people. You know, you get all revved up just to get killed by pandemic flu. It's a horrible irony. And in places where they can't treat people as well, they die quickly. And so it's huge. Look at the 1918 pandemic. There's good reason why it wouldn't be as bad in the United States, but worldwide, it's nearly the same story. As a matter of fact, up until 2007, there was an annual season of children dying in Mexico, right over the border, right? Every year, rotavirus would come in, and it was like lambs to the slaughter. People would just die. A vaccine was rolled out for rotavirus, and the numbers go down. So instead of die, now it's back to those levels that go down. So that's the great part about vaccines. When they're safe and they're done right, they just work. You don't have to believe in them. You don't have to do any of that kind of stuff. Also, when these kids get vaccinated against rotavirus, that's the only thing that they're vaccinated against. It's not some broad-based attack. It's not some antiviral that's killing lots of different things. It's just rotavirus. They're getting a little bit of it, and they don't get the symptoms. So you kind of know what you're doing. You're not going in there and monkeying around with everything. I'm going to move a little bit quicker here just to get through, but this is just a X-ray crystal app that turns into a cartoon. The reason why viruses are so tough to deal with. So anybody know how many vaccines are out there? Not how many times you get a shot, but how many vaccines? Yeah, so yes, I'll close my eyes so you don't get embarrassed. 100, no, 26. 26, after all these years. And most of them were done a long time ago. There's only 26. It's like 1,000 good things to not want to get, right? But 26. And the reason why is because we got the easy ones that you can basically put in a shot, give you a little bit, and you're good to go. But most viruses, since they co-evolved, they've figured out how to get away from the immune system. As a matter of fact, they lever it against you, and they fit in the same grooves you have. So you can't make a simple vaccine against a virus that looks just like you. Your immune system says, no, that's mine. That's my protein. That's my shape. I'm not going to do it. So it's really quite tricky. So cancer, another biggie. The Science Magazine, which is kind of a geek journal, put cancer immunotherapy as the breakthrough of the year for 2014. It's like the cover of Sports Illustrated, if you're a scientist. It's pretty cool. What we liked is the fact that it was immunotherapy. And we were just talking about this, you know, does your immune system normally protect you from cancer? Some people for a long time said no. As a matter of fact, your immune system is not really involved. And then yes, oh it is, and then no it isn't. And we did clinical experiments, not we, people before me, where they took cells that were clearly specific for tumors, they put them into people, didn't cure their cancer. So it seemed like your immune system was there, but it wasn't doing the killing. And we know why now. Doesn't mean we know how to treat everyone, but we know why. Here's how it did it. Here's your cancer cell, okay? And cancer cells are cells that are growing out of control. They forgot how to be good neighbors, so they overgrow everything else, and they end up consuming resources, causing disease, and killing you. Normal cells use these little receptors, so your skin cells, your normal cells in your body. When an immune cell comes up to it, a normal cell has a receptor that says, I'm normal. So if you're an immune cell, don't kill me. And the immune system obeys. Even if it kind of recognizes the cell, it doesn't kill. Well, cancer cells, normally when you start growing out of control, you lose that ability to say, I'm normal. Those things come back, and so tumors can be covered in immune cells. But the tumor cells themselves are telling the immune system to turn off. And until we found these things, it was a total paradox of how a cell could see it but not kill. So what people have done is they've actually made antibodies to cap off that signal, and now the immune system can get back to work. And in certain melanomas that were previously metastatic and were going to kill you, the immune system can get in all the different crevices, identify the cells, kill them, people are cured. And you have long-term immunity. So it's like a vaccine. The other great thing about using your immune system rather than, say, drugs or radiation is that it's very specific. And so anyone who gets cancer, needs to be rescued from it. And so we take great measures. We give you sickening drugs that are like poisons. We give you irradiation. We hit your whole body. You're a very sick person, and you have cancer. If you can go through it and engage the immune system as a first line of defense, you're a healthy person fighting cancerous cells. And so the side effect profile is much lower, and you can be much more aggressive about fighting those cells in particular. It's a whole different way to look at it. Now, what's really interesting in some of the work that we do at the Institute is what cancer cells do is once they start to grow, they need lots and lots of blood. And so they recruit the vasculature to grow a special stock just to give them more blood. And this angiogenesis is actually some of the earlier cancer drugs cut off the angiogenesis. Well, it turns out that not only do the cells grow a new blood vessel and therefore supply some blood, the tumor cells do this little trick and they tell the endothelium, those new blood vessels, to act as kind of barriers to the immune system. And so you have to give it to tumor cells. They know what they want and they get it. Well, what we found is the genes that they suppress, the idea is to unsuppress them, and all of a sudden that same blood supply can be chock full again of immune activity, and very specifically, early cancer. So this is something probably 10 years from. Another whole class of disease, and therefore an area to look at in the immune system, is autoimmune disease. And of course, the name gives away what's going on, self-immune disease. So diabetes is kind of a poster child. It's something that got me into immunology in particular, type 1. It's quite an interesting disease. It shouldn't exist. And the reason why is because your pancreas, an organ right here, helps you with digestion, its exocrine function, and with glucose metabolism through insulin, a hormone. And without insulin, you die. You need it. And if you take a look, this is just a slice of a pancreas. Don't donate your pancreas. It would hurt. It's stuck in the middle of everything. It actually makes it really hard to study. But when you do finally get a piece and you take a look, a normal one has these cells that produce insulin, and there's almost no lymphocytes. There's almost no immune cells that are in there. Sometimes one or two will come through. They'll take a look around. No problem. They just keep going. In the case of type 1 diabetes, this develops. So what this is this is what's called a multiphoton microscope. And so a living, in this case, mouse, is sitting under a microscope, and we're shooting lasers into it to illuminate it from within, and then a microscope lens can see wherever those laser beams intersect and nowhere else. And of course, you move it around very quickly, and you can look at all this stuff live. So what this is a small blood vessel feeding a part of the pancreas. Right here are islets, so the green. But what's labeled in green are immune cells. They're actually T lymphocytes. And remember how I said they should just come in, take a look, and keep going? When a mouse or a person has diabetes, they come in and they accumulate, and they keep accumulating. And pretty soon, they're in there in like a frenzy. And that frenzy ends up killing those insulin-producing beta cells. So it's your immune system circling around in that area they're not supposed to be in that end up destroying the beta cells. And this is a regenerative organ, but eventually, you lose the battle. And the sad part is that because those insulin-producing cells are killed by your immune system, even if you were to put more in through a transplant, your immune system would kill those too. So until you cure the immune component, a transplant of more insulin-producing cells isn't going to help. So again, it's an immune disease. And it just shouldn't exist. Your immune system is basically sacrificing the body in order to attack it. So it's a real head-scratcher. But there are some clues that are coming around as we start to look in humans. And so there's actually a network where human pancreases from people who've died who have diabetes have been taken out, and people around the world are looking at these things. Very interesting things are coming up. What this looks like is if I didn't tell you what was going on, and I didn't tell even somebody who is educated in immunology, they might say, oh, is this a viral infection? And I'd say no, but it looks an awful lot like one, and that's a clue. Is there a viral basis of it? Is there a viral type of immunity that gets activated? All these things are real possibilities in autoimmune diseases, especially in type 1. So I told you that even if you put in a transplant, you'd still have problems because the immune system Remember how I said the immune system can make memories? Well, think about the street you grew up on, especially if you lived there a long time. All right. Okay, ready? One, two, three. Now forget which street you grew up on. You can't. The immune system does the same thing. And it's not abstract the way that it makes memory. It's the same idea. It actually designates cells. They don't forget. They get propagated. You keep them. So in the same way that your central nervous system architects neurons to store this information in a very digital way so that it can recall it with total fidelity, your immune system does the same. So when you talk about getting rid of autoimmune disease, what you're really doing is you're talking about overcoming old ones. You want to reteach your immune system to leave that target alone, to forget you ever saw it. That's really tough. But it's engineering. That's what we have to do. If you do it, it works. We found out accidentally that it'll work because some people with autoimmune diseases had gone through things like chemotherapy, irradiation, immunosuppressive drug treatment, and their autoimmunity goes away. So we already know if you shut down the immune system, it's going to happen. Now we need to make it specific. So in just the last couple minutes, I'm going to talk about a little bit of Futurescape. I think it's a good way to elicit some questions. So let's look in the next 5 to 20 years what immune research should get us, I think. For one thing, we should start to get some disease-specific anti-inflammatory biologics. It's a mouthful, but really what that means is things like Humira. We hear about Humira right now. Humira goes in and it attacks a central part of your immune system, dampens the whole thing, and your autoimmune diseases, psoriasis, IBD, they go away. But you're also immune compromised, so you're susceptible to viruses and everything else. To get that immune suppression more narrowly focused will be a big deal. You won't take a Humira, you'll take something that takes a small segment of the immune system out. That's probably 5 years. Also in probably 5 to 10 years, the idea of probiotics will finally come into something that's not, you know, an internet special or late night TV. So right now, if you bathe yourself in probiotics, you're getting the average probiotic for somebody who's missing probably lactobacillus, right? It's a bunch of yogurt. And the reason why is because it's a very, very specific mosaic of microbes that you want in you. The bacteria aren't randomly in there. They're not just thrown together. They have very specific segments. And so if you're missing a couple, those are the ones you want. Remember when I told you about the lung allergies caused by missing bacteria? It's a very small segment of bacteria. And so if you just showered your lungs with just tons of bacteria, it's not helpful. But using genomic sequencing, we can actually sit and account for all these different things. And just to give you kind of a clue, the genes active in your body, only about 1 in 300 that's keeping you alive are human. The other 300 are bacterial. So this is a big component of what makes you tick. It's a fantastic number. I mean, actually, you're only about, you know, 10 out of 100 cells, or 1 out of 90 cells. Anyway, so you're mostly bacterial. They're just really small. Vaccines to prevent allergic reactions. So allergies are that sustained immune response. It's specific. You get it. You live with it your whole life. And a vaccine, not the hypo shots you get now, but a vaccine that long before you ever even encounter things that you're going to become allergic to, you get. It's kind of cool. Probably 10 years down the line or less. Cancer, unblocking the blocks with blockers, that kind of thing. Vaccines to prevent latent infections. So we are now coming to realize that a lot of viral infections get cleared up in your bloodstream, but they stay latent in other cells. And when you look at certain things, so part of the herpes virus family is cytomegalovirus. And that actually causes more birth defects than the other biggies, fetal alcohol syndrome, Downs, combined. It's a viral infection that gets passed from mother to developing child. Congenital defects result. And then therapies to prevent autoimmunity. I wish this was at the top of the list, but it's not. This is getting rid of memories. What this all is really going to depend on, though, is personalized medicine. So that's an awesome buzzword. Every scientist gets to use it now. What it really means is you come in, and we get a very detailed understanding of your immunity to very specific things. And then we go and make the treatment. So there won't be an off-the-shelf anti-allergic shot. I won't give everybody a shot against pollen and, you're done with pollen. Won't work that way. It's because we're going to make these very specific things that are tuned for your immune system. You've all heard that you can't just give people transplants willy-nilly. That's because your immune system's different. We're genetically almost identical. Immunologically, we're totally different. So each one of these things has to be personalized. And that's good, because right now, when you go into a clinician's office, we get about this personal. We say, well, you're a woman, you weigh, you know, 40 kilograms, here's your pill. That's personal, right? No. So it's going to get a lot more. Actually, I'm going to wrap up here. I was going to tell you a little bit about the Institute, but I think that we're about at that time, right? Is anyone, we good? All right. So we're here, and you're now invited by sitting through this talk. You know somebody who works there, so hope to see you. So, questions?
As a retired pathologist, I found your lecture fascinating.
Thank you.
And encouraging. A question I have is about the Ebola virus.
Mm-hmm.
And since it attacks endothelial cells,
yep.
And since the lung is full of endothelial cells, mm-hmm. why can it be transmitted by droplets through sleep?
Why can't it be?
Well,
I think it can.
Well, that's what we hear now.
Yeah.
Is that it takes copious amounts of fluid like vomitus,
yeah,
and diarrhea to transmit it, and you won't get it if you sneeze. That's what we hear.
Yeah.
In other words, it's not
airborne.
It's not airborne.
Yeah.
So why not?
So I think that what people have relied on when they characterize airborne or not is how labile it is in the environment. And, you know, if you sneeze and it instantly comes to room temperature and then it doesn't land on some warm surface, that it inactivates almost immediately. But, you know, if you have vomiting, so I worked in the emergency room for a little while, if you have vomiting or projectile vomiting, right, which one is the latter airborne? That kind of thing. With the sneezing and all the other fluid ejector that come out, that's how people get it. So I think that what that oversimplification has done is it's tried to tell people it's not anthrax, right? You can't take a clot of it, throw the spores in the air, give it a week, and still get sick. It's very short-term in the environment. But I just don't think the CDC believes that people will understand that complicated message. But if anybody that has Ebola sneezes on you or coughs on you, you're right there with it. Yeah. Yeah. It's not like your lung has inactivated the virus and therefore if it comes out, you know. I mean, yeah, So I don't want to scare anybody, you know. But I think it's an oversimplification.
So you mentioned that the tumor cells block the blood or immune cells from the blood going into the tumor?
Kind of. What they do is interferons. So we've heard of interferons in the past as chemotherapy. Interferons are these things that the immune system makes to basically bristle up and get really agitated. As a matter of fact, when you have viral infections, you release interferons and everything just kind of lights up and it gets aggressive. What tumors do is they pull in the vasculature and then they convince endothelial cells not to release interferon even though they're doing abnormal things. So they dampen it down. And then they combine it with the fact that once immune cells go in, they inactivate them as they walk in. It's almost like they give them like an amnesiatic drug, right? They forget why they're there. They kind of wander around, they leave again. It's really like an engineering experiment where the tumor creates a safe place to live, pulls the blood, and makes a barrier to keep the immune system at bay.
Why don't we apply that to people with diabetes and put it inside the pancreas?
Yeah. I think that the idea, if it turns out that there's a local inflammatory lesion and it's because the cells that are diseased or having problems are turning off the immune system, that will be a frontline defense. It's a great idea. Imagine how delivering that to a specific place is going to be a challenge. But so what? It's hard. You know, it's not impossible. And I think that that's the kind of stuff that people will think about. I mean, what if you have an autoimmune disease because there's a virus inside a cell? In other words, we think it's just the immune system attacking your healthy cell. But what if there's actually something in it? Then we're going to have to do exactly what you're talking about. We're going to have to convince the immune system to overcome its natural urge to leave normal alone and to kill it. And then once all the virus is gone, then stop attacking. It's really complicated. It is.
Thank you.
Well, type 2, it turns out, turns into a real inflammatory disease after a while. And then type 1 turns into almost a metabolic syndrome. They're going to reclassify it in a couple years into basically a spectrum of how the onset happened and then what you're suffering from. Because some people, it's purely a metabolic issue, and some people, it's purely immunologic, but most people are somewhere in the middle. So the epidemiology gets confusing, because if you are borderline diabetic and then you get sick, that's usually when you, well, it's usually when you find out. Because the way that you're living right before you have overt diabetes is you're in what's called a honeymoon period, where you're making just barely enough, and then some crisis puts you over the edge. Some people actually go in and out of the hospital a couple of times without being diagnosed, because when they recover from whatever was making them sick, kind of goes away. That being said, yeah, there's actually growing evidence that the immune system, which is the thing that sustains that ultimately gets you, is there for a reason. And it's probably not the kind of infections that you're thinking. It's probably enteroviruses. Right. Things that tend to be very, they come and go. You actually get like heart inflammation and others, and organ inflammation, and you don't even notice it for most people. But then the immune system just never walks away. That's all hypothetical. That is what a lot of the data is suggesting. I'm gonna go back over this way, so let's do one here.
The samples you were discussing to address widening the arteries and taking out the inflammation, could you ever use those for rheumatoid arthritis and decreasing inflammation?
You could, and you know, some people are probably getting some like passive benefit, because almost everybody over 40 is a candidate for statins. It's kind of strange. They're incredibly safe drugs, you know, when you look at the general population. But they're not a very strong one. So if you have overt rheumatoid arthritis, you usually have to get into pretty heavy-duty stuff to get real relief. And the statin mechanism is mostly, I mean, the drug kind of does what it's supposed to, which is to lower cholesterol in a lot of cases. So there are better ones. We'll go here.
Okay. So there's 26 vaccines that focus the immune system, or
just traditional vaccines.
Yeah. So
it turns out that your immune system, when it recognizes something specifically, it makes a decision to either specifically attack and remember this attack protocol, or to do a thing called tolerance, and specifically become tolerant. And it's actually irreversible. Once you're tolerant to something, you leave it alone permanently. And the signaling is really close. It's almost like if you look at binary. And so if you take out a couple of signals while you're showing the thing you want, you get a tolerogenic signal. It may be why some vaccines we've developed in the past cause us to be specific but not effectively immune. So we were doing it right, but we were making them tolerant vaccines. It's really cool. You can tolerize people to all sorts of things, but to do it therapeutically is very novel. For one thing, how do you measure non-activity, right? So it's an awful clinical trial to run. Drug companies don't like those. You know, it's like sick or not sick, but like, you know, nothing is hard to measure. So, here. Yeah, a lot of it is pretty core. Every cancer, and every is a big word, right? But every cancer probably diverges differently. So even the same cell types that become cancerous tend to mutate and have to escape from the immune system in a different way. And this is why sometimes chemotherapies against cancers work on almost all of them from that cell type, and then some work on very few. But it really always comes down to this inability to commit suicide. So cells naturally grow, and if they start to overgrow, there's a, it's like the an elevator. You know, if you pull the cord, it has that auto break. Cells have the same sort of thing. They kill themselves. It's totally normal. You just grow more. You have stem cells. Cancer cells forget how to do that. So that part was actually figured out a while ago. The trick is to how do you now go and find those cells and destroy them? Because after all, they're you. And so cancer kind of hides amongst you and looks like you. And the chance of any one cell becoming cancerous might be 1 in 100 billion, maybe 1 in 1 trillion. They're really rare. But they've got plenty of time. And this is why over time your risk of certain cancers goes up, because eventually the numbers game comes in. So the evolution of cancer makes it really hard to attack. But now that you know all that, what if we can very quickly take your cancer, pull it out, and sequence it? Now, a couple years ago, this would have cost billions of dollars. Now it costs a couple thousand. In 5 years, it'll cost a couple $100. It'll be like going in for, I mean, your dentist will probably sequence you. It'll be cheap. So now that you can sequence everything, let's do it. Because then you can find out the very small, tiny little difference between that cancer and the normal cells and target something. That's what people are starting to do. That receptor I showed you that blocks the immune system, it's actually one of a family. There's 200 of them or something like that. We're still finding them. So each cancer uses different combinations of them. And sometimes if you only block one, there's another thing out there. But the theory is that we'll be able to go through the human population, categorize how cancers escape, and then when you become sick, we'll go in and say, you fit into this kind of cancer with this kind of blocking. Now we'll use these drugs, and we'll use them first. So you'll have a very good immune system to fight it. And then if all that fails, then we nuke you. So Alzheimer's is just starting to become recognized as something that is an immune disease because of, you know, the arterial sclerotic plaques that we see. Forms of Alzheimer's, the predominant forms, have plaques as well. It's debris. And if theory holds up, what it will be is this immune response, this failed immune response to clean things up without causing more damage. And we'll start to deal with that. Here's the problem. In your heart, it's really obvious where it started, the stuff that's involved, because we've been studying it for such a long time. The idea that it's immunologic in your brain is actually a really new idea. For a while, your brain was considered immunoprivileged, a place your immune system doesn't go. And then it's kind of like you were standing in a dark room, you turn on the lights, oh wait, there's immune cells everywhere, these astrocytes. But now that we know that, there's a group of neuroimmunologists who are looking into it. In 5 to 10 years, I don't think so. I mean, this is a tough one. But on the outside of that, yes. I think what people may start to do is say, if you are, you know, pre-Alzheimer's and there's a drug that specifically inhibits the activity of some of the cells there, that might come first, but it's a tough one. It's way down the list. I hope it's sooner than that. I mean, I plan on living a long time, so I'm gonna be right there going, you know, give me my Alzheimer's. Thank
you.
Yeah, so I think that where the future of medicine really is rich is that we look at people as the individuals they are and provide them with vaccines and medicines early that essentially prime their immune system. Now, vaccines sound like an awful thing, and anybody who wants to get more sounds like a nut, right? Because it sounds like, wait, I'm going to get more shots? That's terrible, right? Well, as it turns out, you are constantly bombarded. When I give somebody a vaccine, they're getting a little tiny dose of a little tiny thing. It hurts like bejesus, but it actually, for your immune system, is no big deal. The delivery system, though, right now is very general. We give it to everybody about the same, and on average, it helps everybody. Where it will change, if it's effective, is that a few preventative things. So imagine that they were like the oral Sabin vaccine for polio, right? Where you ate something, and in eating it, you stimulated your immune system. It could practice against a whole bunch of different things. I mean, let's throw some biggies out there. HIV, Ebola, right? All of them, why not, right? All these things are not gonna be the real virus. They're gonna be these little representations of it. You do that, and it's like you just went to the tropics and got exposure without getting the actual virus, that kind of stuff. But I can't give that to you and your neighbor and expect the same thing to happen. I have to make one for you. And so it's gonna take a lot of, you know, going up to the kiosk and giving a little blood and doing sequencing and then making the thing for you. But it should work, and it should actually work a lot better, because right now I give probably too much measles to you and not enough to me sometimes. Vaccines don't always work, right? But if I measured you first and then made the vaccine, I'd make it perfect, just for you. So, okay, if I don't go to this side of the room, they're gonna attack me. So now I'm gonna, right here, and then you. Yeah, no, it's a great question. So like, you know, you only have so many cells of the immune system, right? And what if the cell that's really good at fighting a certain virus happens to be trafficking down through your ankle, but the virus comes into your arm, right? That's the question, right? How does it get there? Well, there is a system that I think the best way to describe it is like a zip code. So the cells that are under fire send out a general danger alarm. And they say, I am being attacked by a virus. And they make that area more permissive for cells of all specificities to come in and take a look. At the same time, cells that were there at the time of attack run to a specialized lymphoid area called a lymph node or germinal center. And that's like a crossroads where all of these immune cells eventually come by and take a look. And it's a rogues gallery. Like going to, you know, this is, you're way too young for this, but you know, the wanted posters in the, imagine an old west in the post office, they go by and it's like, oh, that's a character and he's up in your shoulder. I know what that is. They know how to go back in there and they can find it through this zip coding system where there's signals. Now, you know, why isn't your body alight in these signals? Because you're constantly getting all that kind of stuff. We aren't exactly sure, but it's pretty clear that immune cells have a short attention span. And so they very quickly go all over the place. And then when there's signals that they see, they can see it and stop on a dime, get the positive encouragement, and then they go, and what they do is they make hundreds of thousands, millions, or billions of clones of themselves. And now the frequency of the cell that's specific goes really high, right? So if you have just one cell that fights a virus and it going to the right place is pretty low. But if you make a billion copies, and your blood's filled with them, the likelihood those are gonna get to the right place goes way up. So that clonal expansion is what does it. So it's kind of complicated, but it's basically that happens. And then once they're done and they run out of targets that they see, they die. So you just let them die. That's why you're not full of immune cells. You know, you're not bursting at the seams. So they ramp up, kill, and go away. Autoimmune disease, they ramp up, kill, stay ramped up. So right now, if you look across the human population, there's all these different serotypes. We used to think about it in terms of transplant antigens, right? So siblings were close but not perfect. Distant genealogic people would be very different. Your immune system actually uses those transplant antigens to show the things that bother it. And so since we're all different, the way that it actually takes a virus and shows immune cells is different. Why is that? Well, evolutionarily, if we were all clones, then a single virus could wipe us out. So we're all different enough so that any one pathogen looks different, is pretty different, we can duck and weave and get away from this thing. Well, that also makes it really tough when you're making vaccines because the same thing is gonna be shown differently. So how can we do it? Well, we've started. So we've actually started to catalog. We actually do it at the Institute. So it's a relatively small place, but for immunologists, it's a big deal. It's a thing called the Immune Epitope Database. It shows everything we know, I mean everything, 20 million different references about how the immune system sees tuberculosis in you, me, different, all by blood type. And once you have that giant database, now when you come in, I'll say, well, let me look in the database and see how you're going to see this pathogen, and your little elixir is going to be different. You won't get the whole pathogen. You'll just get the little pieces that you see best. I'll get different ones. That's the theory. It actually works. Sugar in general? Yeah, so metabolic issues seem to be a real impact on it. So if you have, if you're hypercaloric, if you have other metabolic things, your body reuses hormones and signals for lots of different things. And so if you are hypercaloric, have certain BMIs, it appears that you echo the same symptoms of stress, corticosteroids, and essentially you're sending out immunosuppressive signals. Now on the flip side, you're also chronically inflamed. So it's like you're stressed and your immune system's angry. And this is because it appears that when you're, and then again, this is some of the new thinking, we're evolutionarily designed to sort of eat and starve and eat and starve. And when you have a chance to really stock up on calories, your body's like, hold the phone. Let everything else wait. Eat. Because we don't know when this is going to happen again. And so you're trading energetically for that kind of stuff. But again, it's could be. And then there, you know, then there's, you know, other things that come into play. You know, if you eat too much of one thing, your microbiome, the bacteria in you, become adjusted to that, and they sort of neglect other ways to react, and then you're all out of kilter in terms of dysbiosis. I don't know. So like psoriasis and those things, I'm not a super expert, but topical, all the dermatitises and everything else are starting to become more prevalent, as all allergies and autoimmune diseases are. So they could be related.
You mentioned about autoimmune disease being a hyper-responsive immune system.
Yes.
And cancer being a hypo-responsive.
That's right.
But there are people with cancer and autoimmune disease coexisting.
I know, what the heck.
Body, so
yeah.
How do you explain that?
So, yeah, it's awful. So it turns out that the rate of getting, or the likelihood and probability of getting just any autoimmune disease in general, or cancer in general, looks like the same curve over age. In other words, the older you get, both go up. And the reason is complicated, but, I'm sorry all the stuff, I say complicated. I don't mean it because you can't understand complicated things. What I mean by that is I'm leaving out a lot of the detail. What it appears is that with autoimmune disease and with cancer, it's a numbers game. In other words, the likelihood through errors, accumulated errors, play into it. And this is why time hurts you. Your immune system in the cancer game is fighting this numbers game of escape mutants. So more chances for cells to become cancerous and get away and figure out the magic combination of evading the immune system. That's why that goes up over time. Autoimmune disease, that's tougher, because that suggests that you're accumulating risk. You know, if you are susceptible to an autoimmune disease and it takes a long time, does that mean you have to keep running into the same environmental stimuli, viruses? You know, what's going on there? That one's not so clear. But it is a real trend. Most autoimmune diseases are more prevalent with age. And they shift younger when you get into certain environments. So, yeah, I don't know. But in both cases, you can have a fully healthy immune system and get both. So that's, you know, it's not like, there are a couple of cancers that are interesting. If you have alopecia, the likelihood of getting melanoma is lower, right? Because it's the same melanin cells that can attack. So when you attack them, get alopecia, your likelihood of certain melanomas goes down. And that seems to be because it's the same immune reaction. But again, was there another question over here?
You mentioned stress.
I think so. I think so. I mean, you know, it's, again, I'm like a caveman here whacking things with a giant club. I don't know exactly which parts of the stress you should manage, but the cortisols and the things that are part of the stress response are clearly factored into it. I mean, your immune system is so pervasive that whenever you've got these major shifts from normal, it's going to involve the immune system. I wish I had that answer, though. I'm a high energy person, so I think I introduce a lot of stress. I'd probably live longer personally, but I don't know how. Everybody got it, and once it goes around the world, then everybody who lives is immune. That's it. It's terrible.
What would the, you were able to vaccinate each person individually, what would that do to the current pediatric vaccination schedule?
Oh, it changed it. So right, I have a 7-year-old. So you go in, and you get shots, and you want to give your very young children vaccines, right? Because, I mean, if you're going to prevent... Well, if you're going to prevent a childhood disease, you shouldn't wait till they're adults. It doesn't make any sense. So you give them, and because the vaccines have to be very, very safe, they're very low dose, and so you have to get boosters. Well, now you're giving more shots, and all people remember is shots, babies and shots. And it's like, good God, you know, how many times am I going to shoot my kid? Well, I mean, try measles, right? Try mumps, try all these other, you know, whooping cough, and you'd wish you got the shot. So the difference is if we go into subunit vaccines, that's what these things are when they start to personalize, we may be able to combine more and more things, because right now it appears that even though your body is really plastic and able to respond to a lot of things at once, the way we formulate vaccines classically, if you put too many things in at once, they basically compete for how well you'll become immunized.